get the color which you're describing.
Check this.
To give them back. Thank you. It's such a pleasure to start an event exactly on time, 7 p.m., with a full house. I know this is love for Saeed, and I'm delighted to be part of that. My name is Kartika. I'm the publisher at Westland and Context, which has published this wonderful book. And welcome all of you to the official launch of this book. I worked with Saeed before when I was in another publishing house, and we published a novel. And it's a novel that one deeply loved for its ability to look back and tell stories about the past and about different cultures with such erudition that you quite forgot that this was a novel and not a book that was meant to inform and educate and thrill, all of which it did. From then to here, it's a completely different narrative, but I think the truth-telling that that book did and this one does are in some ways similar. The narratives come straight from the heart. You can feel the wisdom and tell that this comes from many years of thinking about that 500 words waiting for Saeed to arrive. The flight had landed, he'd been picked up, he came to the festival. It was this beautiful setting where conversations were about to start, sessions are going on. And I said, Saeed sir, you know, there's this session going on, shall we go in and attend it? And he looked at me and then he looked at the sky and he said, but the sun is going down, isn't there a bar somewhere? And I said, okay.
Thank you very much, Kartika. And in this particular instance, one call from Saeed, and there was no question of not saying yes. Firstly, it's not often that I get to see him, so that was that. He's a traveler. He lives in two different parts of the country. And so this was one of great opportunity. Also, it's been a while since I've had occasion, and this is my personal selfish reason, but I've had occasion to sit with him and discuss several things. I know a few of these things that he has written about because he has been sharing with me. In fact, one particular, I knew I was looking forward to it, and when this invitation came, there was no question. This is an easy read because it's written very fluently, but it's also a somewhat, I wouldn't say disturbing, but definitely a thoughtful read. It makes you think about a lot of things. It's about memory, nostalgia. Saeed, it's a bit about nostalgia, I must say, that you are in your romantic phase also here, but it's also about loss. So these are some of the overall themes that have come through, but essentially these are small pieces about, quite honestly, I have a feeling that many of us sitting here and elsewhere have been thinking about too, about what the country used to be, what the world used to be, will we go from here. At this moment in India's history, in world history also, there are many disturbing things. This is not a prognosis. It's certainly not a dissection or an analysis. It's one person's view, but the way it is done, where Saeed talks about everything, about his childhood, about growing up, about getting involved in seeing world issues around him, these are issues that, I may say, we all grew up with, a lot of people grew up with, and for a newer readership will, but it's a personal view. And say that was my first question. That's a personal view. You've written about everything from the building you grew up in, Fonseca Mansion, which I understand
Is it on? You know, it sounds eclectic perhaps. Excuse me, sorry. Ashutosh Gowari, you thought. Looks eclectic, but it was a way of kehte khayalon ko sametna. I never was localized. I was always an internationalist in my soul, the way I was brought up. So therefore, I tried to see things both locally and internationally simultaneously. And the point is, how do you do it? How can you construct a novel? Sorry, I will take that word. Construct a book that can contain the international and the local, and in that give it some kind of a coherence. It's a deeply political book, but backed by, I think, moments of lyricism, moments of loss sense, a sense of loss, but by and large, the overarching idea is political. Now that was the attempt in this book. How far I've achieved it, I'm not so sure. I never am sure. But to me, these are constructs of mine. I can see myself like, I don't write a book. They're installations in my mind. And then I put them together, and I hope like hell they become linear to my reader, so that they can somehow hold on to it, follow it. Because that's the way I see things. Because that's the only way I can come to terms with the world as I try to decode it. This is the only construct that I can use in terms of literature. That's the way I've functioned. So I hope I've answered your question.
No, there's no one answer to it, because we want the idea of hope. There is a chapter called Hope at the end.
It has the audacity of hope, because it has, in these times of hate, where hate is the flavor of the time we live in, and is a marketable commodity. It's so life-affirming to find a compassionate voice erupting from these pages, and that too from a filmmaker made movies of anger. And in fact, I was telling Aziz, Aziz, yaar, ye film mein aisi banata tha, iski itni intimate, warm, compassionate, jo ek awaaz hai, why couldn't that surface in his movies? And I think it reminds me of a saying, there was a Jewish rabbi who said something when I was young and stupid, I used to be dazzled by eloquence. But as I've gone older, the only thing that touches me is human kindness. I think what is unique about this book, that even when you tear the opponent to shreds, you have the ability to reflect. You have the ability to look at your warts and you question whether you have rubbed them the wrong way or you have been overtly critical when they should perhaps be applauded. So I think this is a very unique book, and as I entered, I said, this is a very good book. Alim Bakshi Sahib used to say, ki bhaiya kitab agar dost ki hai to achhi hai, dushman ki to bahut buri hai. Tum dost to achhi hai, magar this is an extraordinary book because it has the audacity of hope, and it's not, it looks unflinchingly at the reality. It reminds me of Sahir Sahib's song, Wo Subah Kabhi To Aayegi, uska ek mukhra tha jo istemal nahi hua tha, jo humne hamari film Begum Jaan mein istemal kiya tha, ki wo subah hum hi se aayegi. Wo subah kabhi to aayegi nahi, wo subah hum hi se aayegi. So here we are at this moment saying, we will bring that dawn which has, because we can't allow people to wrench away the soul of India by anyone. And let us not confuse, no matter what mandate a political party gets, the nation is not the government. The nation's soul is much bigger than any government. This is what resonates in every page of this book, and that is why I think this book is an extraordinary book. This is an extraordinary book.
Actually, he said something in the beginning, which Ritu, I was going to ask you anyway. It's very, the humanity is very clear. Is this, you think, a message for, as he also ended, is this a message for today? Is this a book about today? It's a book about yesterday, but is it about today?
Yeah, very much so, because for me, I think it's one of the most political books I've read in a very, very long time. In the context of, talking about the manufactured divide or what the idea of India was. And I think that comes up very clearly in the mansions and in the growing up the community. But also it links up the lynching of, in 93, I think you talked about the possible linking of that pink man, which is there, the lynchings which are going on now, the issues of stopping at a grave to pay your respect without knowing the community of that grave. For me, that was something which is very, very essential. And the defining structure, and this is something I find will also appeal very, very much, not only to people like us who are, so-called, read a lot or theorize a lot, but also to a lot of young people. And the defining structure or the defining element of this book is really, I think, the poetry of the collective. That is something which comes out for me very, very strongly. So at one level, you have the hope component, but it's also like Sufism ek hota tha na, hamara aapne bhi bola, ke tu hi dard hai aur tu hi dawa hai. So it's in the questions which you have raised where I find the answers. So it's not so much hope despair for me as a reflection of a reality and a philosophical poetic reflection of a reality. That is the...
But to think that it's all coming out, tumbled out from you in the pages of this one volume, surely there are many volumes possible, but the fact that you put it all in one means that many of these things have been inside you for years. Whether as romantic notions or warmth or human this, or there are troubling questions here, of course, but they've been with you for years. When you write about what you felt about standing in Vietnam, or about Cassius Clay, Muhammad Ali, or indeed about that old man who was on a cycle during the riots in 93. And I must tell you, when he's talking about memory and amnesia, We are all from this city. The fact of the matter is this city has forgotten 92-93. It has completely forgotten it. The anniversary, 25th anniversary came and went and there was no recording of it. So all that, is it the distillation of years of thought that is going back to what I had asked, but again I need to ask that. How did it happen?
It doesn't mean it's forgotten. This is a manufactured forgetfulness. And this is what my whole thing is about, is manufactured forgetfulness so that we can go on to the next riot. We can do another regime change, we can invade another country, let's get involved with the tattoo on Virat Kohli's shoulder or Salman Khan's chest, you know. Let's get engaged with that or the mansion of an Ambani. What is the cost of it, you know, or a party thrown by somebody, we get engaged. And this is stuff that is being dished out, which keeps us occupied.
All right, but all great political movements or religious movements or artistic leaps have taken place in the womb of loneliness. So I think in that heart of loneliness, as you inch toward what is called the wisdom, middle life of wisdom, the wisdom years, this book flowered from you. And I think what it does make one point is the Saeed is the most relevant voice. It's not an old man lamenting about the time that was. He passionately engages with the stream of life and says, I will lead from the front and I will dare you. I will not walk there and I will change the course of where things are going. And I think that is what I applaud in Saeed, because he comes to your office, walks up and says, I want you there. He comes with this book. And when I open this book, what staggers me is his insight, his simplicity, and his passion, and his ability to hope. And I think we need to believe in that, that those who have made hopelessness into, you know, the be-all and the end-all, need to understand that it's the brave who can hope. Because hope compels you to engage. Hopelessness, the same narrative being dished out, you can't do it. Here you are through this book, and you know, I had the privilege to meet this guy called Muntazir Al Zaidi, whom you have mentioned. The guy in that fascinating discussion between the gangster and the journalist, and you come to that guy who we did a play called The Last Salute, where we called him because we based a play on his biography. And he came, he's an Iraqi young man. He came straight and he landed and he went to the Rajghat and he paid respect to Gandhi and kept on talking about Gandhi. And I asked him only one thing. I said, Muntazir, before you hurled that shoe, what happened? He says, I came to terms that they're going to kill me. They're going to execute me. But when I was sitting down there, I had my hand to travel from year to year, this journey from year to year, and to pick it up and hurl it, defined who I was, because there I was doing the job of voicing the anguish of the Iraqi people. And he said, I have never felt more powerful, because I felt that I was perhaps born for this. I think this book in a way does that. It does what Muntazir did. And those who feel that that book was, that the shoe throwing image was just a demonstration of some frustrated journalist, and look, and in fact they turned it around and said, wow, look at the accommodated spirit of George W. Bush, and this is democracy. But I think that did succeed in amplifying what the world media failed to do. They did not bring the truth of what was playing out in the hearts of the people. So I met a CNN journalist who said, we are guilty of not amplifying what's going on there. I think that one journalist, by daring to risk being killed, achieved through that gesture. And that is how it has been found a place in his book. So I think this book will create an impact. It will move things, because there are millions of people out there who will feel connected to this book.
Ritu, actually there is an interesting link with it before, if you could just address that also. That he writes about that Iraqi statue coming down and says that the truth was being manufactured because there were only 100 odd people standing there. But the focus was so tightly kept that the statue coming down looked as though masses of Iraqis.
You know, in fact, the title when I was going through it was more, and after I went through the book, it's in the age of amnesia, but it's a manufactured amnesia, and which is what I think is trying to be broken. So it's an appeal in a way to break the veils, to move the veils, to see what is going on behind. And for me, it brought back, you know, of course, what happened there, the role of the media, etc., etc., but also how our minds are diverted in different kinds of ways, like by some kind of a different action going around. We're so busy laughing at that clown Trump, that basics, break the veils, see the past, learn from the past, but look at the future. And I, this is what, that's why I hope it's translated into Marathi and different languages, because it's an appeal for different people to come together in different sections to come together.
A few other places. But why don't we see mass protests? Why don't we see people coming out on the streets and saying, you know, this was a country in which people came out on the streets against the Vietnam War at one time. But today, the protests that happened last in this city by Dalits and tribals, these were the two last big protests. This is a city which has been run very, very badly, but nobody is coming out on the streets and protesting. Are we becoming apathetic? Are we becoming busy? Are we becoming saying kisi koi aur karega? Or are we becoming so preoccupied by success, material success, that we think it doesn't matter? Why do you think that is happening?
Most of us belong to a class, a social class of people where we're not really concerned about the future in a sense. But when you look on 90% of the people of this country, I think there's an incredible fear of the present. Where are we going to go? In terms of, you know, how do you live? How do you get a job? How do you survive? And you know, when you realize something very simple, that education does not pay any longer. This entire myth of education, I mean, you can see it across the board, that, you know, go to any cooperative society, housing society, and all the liftmen happen to be, you know, from UP or behind, some of them are graduates. What's happened in the present? There is just no hope for the future, in a sense, with these people, and therefore the terror of the present. There's a terror of living in the present for all of them. And then what is my fear? There is anger. And my fear is, how will it be channelized? Because you will find students who are questioning the state of affairs. This is a fact. It's not being revealed in the press. This is true. All over the country. In Kerala, in Tamil Nadu, in Karnataka, in Maharashtra, in Bengal, in UP, Bihar, ho raha hai. Ho raha hai. And I don't think Gujarat mein ho raha hai. Ye ho raha hai. So to say that the youth or the young people today are not, they are, only start in the news.
Actually, then you've just brought in something that I thought the others would say something. Yeah. Why is the media behaving in the way it is?
It has no choice.
Well, sections of the media.
It has no choice. I mean, you have this revealed.
In my journey through life, I have once met a very big media baron. And I was ranting and raving about the apathy of newspaper towards the social issues which were there in that region. So he was amused by my anger, and he, after some time, when we went to his room, he closed the door and he said something to me which stayed with me. He said, "Ke Mahesh saab, maine 500 crore rupaye lagaye hain taaki wo 1000 crore rupaye." अब आपको अगर लगता है कि मैं यहाँ पर समाज की सेवा में वो सारे 500 करोड़ को आग लगा दूंगा, तो ये आपकी बेवकूफी है। ये मेरा जरिया है, हम दुकानदार हैं, इट्स द बिजनेस ऑफ न्यूज। तो हमारा पेशा आपसे बिल्कुल अलग है ही नहीं। ये आप हम पे थोप रहे हैं और हमको एक्ट करना पड़ता है कि हम हाँ आपसे अलग है. In fact, I was quite surprised that in a television debate, Mr. Nitin Gadkari was asked by Mr. Awasthi, कि साहब आपने ये गोवा का कैसे कर दिया. इसे देखिए साहब, अभी महेश साहब आए हैं, विद्या बालन जी आए हैं, अब ये दिल्ली के दौरे क्यों कर रहे हैं, अपनी पिक्चर को बॉक्स ऑफिस भेंट करने के लिए ना, तो बॉक्स ऑफिस ही चाहिए. और फिल्म को बनाते वक्त बहुत कुछ ही बोलेंगे, फिल्म में ये है वो मिलेंगे, तो हमारा भी सत्ता है पूरा. तो मैंने कहा गडकरी साहब बड़ी खुशी हुई इस बात के जान के कि हमको लगा आप हमसे अलग है, हमाम में सब नंगे. तो शायद बचपन में हमको माँ ने पढ़ाया था कि हमसे ये अलग है, राजनेता जो है वो हमारी तरह ओछा नहीं, हम तो दुकानदार है भैया, हम तो भाण विदासी, हम तो नाचते हैं मेकअप करके, जो जैसा गाना बोलोगे हम गा देते हैं. तो इसीलिए हम भी अलग नहीं है आपसे, हमारे लिए. And I found it rather refreshing that he said that in a public face. तो ये तो अब हम खुलेआम बोलेंगे कि the pursuit of power is the be all and the end all, and the values that you keep on talking about, if you keep on raising it, then I will look at you with disdain and say how naive he is. This is the real world. So I think that is what is the issue. And individually, I think we all know that we are living in rather overwhelming times. Each one of us does not know in a blink of an eye the world changes. Individually, I can't do a damn thing, Siddharth. Collective action means war. Means getting into some political party, organizing, getting a cadre together, my boys against your boys. That is what it boils down to. And then it inevitably leads to the same thing. The key people today who are in the seat of power was saying that we will get rid of the tyrants who have played hell with you. So you want to get rid of them with your kind of ideology. So I think, meanwhile, the issue that we need to look at is the values that he keeps on raising, irrespective of the political party that comes to power. Can we have the values which kind of really defined us?
Those values are important.
Are important, and what the hell are you going to do in order to protect that? And I think books and writers and seers and thinkers, who are social engineers actually, or social artists as they say, who do not only paint on the canvas but go and paint on the world outside, are essentially committed to doing this. And I think that is what is the tearing needle of the time. And I see, yes, there is gloom and doom and a sense of deepening helplessness and a kind of growing cynicism which is there. But that also comes from a sense of a kind of a cowardice. You know, somebody asked Mother Teresa, Mother Teresa, humse kuch nahi hoga. You are very great, yeah. Humse nahi hoga. She said, come on, you, by calling me great, you're actually escaping from the responsibility of doing things yourself. You don't mean a damn thing. So I think if Saeed can do it, anybody can do it. And I think that's where the hope is ignited by this.
I think there's a lot going, of course, the role of the media. I mean, that's why we need wire.
Mood of upliftment.
Of course.
I'm very glad. So
yeah.
Can you tell us a bit,
yes,
about that?
Exactly.
You must remember that I happen to be, I'm over the hill. I'm on the other side of the hill in terms of age.
No,
when you see young people who start questioning, you know, it started with the fact when we had this agitation at the Film and Television Institute. And then you had those writers giving back, even the attack on Muhammad Akhlaq, and giving back the Sahitya Academy Award. The protest that started at the FTR, then went into JNU, then went into. And you realize that you aren't alone. And suddenly it was at the NIDs, and it was in Bangalore, then it was in Chennai, Ahmedabad, it's all over the place. And then you realize something very simple, that there is this anger which is being voiced, which is being ignored. What was your question actually before that? Yeah, and then you had people like suddenly Kanhaiya. He catches the imagination of people, but have you noticed what's happened to him? Media-wise, removed. Media-wise, he's just removed from the scene because he is a person, a young man, who can lead. He's a leader of men and women. You see the potential, and therefore such men are dangerous. And now he'll be called tukde tukde. He'll be called all kinds of things because there is a genuine fear for this kind of person also. Don't forget Jignesh Mirvani. Incredible people. Incredible. And then that Omar Khalid. What are they being branded as? You branded them already, Maoists, the urban Maoists. Look what the branding is. And then, now luckily these people are, they are in public awareness. Or a Rana, you, in public awareness. What happened to those six guys who were picked up and just shot dead in Madhya Pradesh? And they were called anti-national terrorists. Six laborers. Daily wage earners picked up from six spots, something called anti-national, threat to national security, and shot dead. And then they planted weapons on these chaps. What do you
call mass? Mass consumption compels you to cater to the lowest common denominator. That is what we have, you know, grown up with. Unless you endorse, perpetuate, and defend the value system, you will not find mass success. So any alternate thought needs an alternate platform, and those platforms are disappearing. But there is a hope that with the digital age descending on us, that alternate voice will finally percolate down. I think there is a change which is taking place. We can't see it, but there is a rage which is fermenting. Oasis somewhere in this
desert. Don't put too much this. I think we've covered a lot of ground and we've intrigued people about this. There will be questions. So I have only one request. Keep the question short and tell us who you're asking for. Before that, Saeed, there was a question, there was a thought that I think we can manage 3 or 4 minutes. Would you like to read some? What do you feel? You've just come out of a house collapse or something. What do you feel?
No, you're lying in a hospital bed. You're recovering from shock and trauma that might come to your patients. What do you feel? You know, it's incredible. What terrorist is
huh? I think I'll make life simpler.
It's called A Tale of Reaching Out. A few years ago, I was driving on a dusty road in the Gulbarga district of Karnataka when I noticed some graves under a huge shady tree in a vast empty field. The image was surreal because the tree seemed to be flourishing in a parched landscape. It was as though its only function was to protect the graves from the blazing heat. The image of the tree and the graves returned to me. As we neared the truck, I asked my chauffeur, come Man Friday, Ayub, to stop the car in reverse. My wife Jennifer, sitting at the back of the car, was surprised. Why are we reversing? She asked. Those graves look so incredibly lonely, so I'm going to pay them a visit. What's the graves? I looked at the graves solemnly for a while and then up at the tree. In this desolate landscape, the grave seemed to be in the perfect shady spot. Who were the people buried here? The grave did not look very ancient. Were they members of a family? Who did this empty and dusty field belong to? Were they descendants of the people in the graves? Since the grave looked somewhat abandoned, I also wondered if there was a caretaker to look after them. As these thoughts crossed my mind, I noticed that the truck driver and the cleaner had also joined us and was standing next to the graves in silence. We stood for some more moments of
So questions quickly. We spoke about 500 crores being turned into 1,000 crores. And when we were questioned about what the, in terms of films, why can't film be paid to take up this cause? And you're back to the same thing, 550 crores in the film, I have to recover money out of it. How is it any different?
No, we have no illusions. We are in the business of entertainment and we never in the mainstream, at least the industry that I joined where we made popular films, which was committed to getting bums on the seat. Our beyond the end all was box office. We never claimed to ourselves. I think Saeed represented that alternate stream, which made films which was not committed to that ideology. one tried in one's lifetime to make movies like Saransh and Adith and Sakun, which kind of did for personal gratification. But the business of entertainment is committed only to getting numbers. And I don't expect the news business to be different. But as I said, like I imagined Mr. Gadkari was different from me. I imagine that the newspaper that came to my house was run by people with conscience, and they kept the principles before profit, till I discovered that's something which they sell. They are exactly like us. So that's why I said, which I told to Nitin Kadri sir, hamam mein sab nange. He said, haan sab nange. We all want power over profit is more important. Principles are not so important.
I think somebody there, I think we can have the discussion.
We can have the discussion.
Aye. Photo.
Aye.
Is kaam ke liye aaya hu.
Yeah, photo op. Is this a photo op?
Yeah.